Good morning, committee. Thank you very much indeed for coming in recess to the Planning and Development Management Committee today, 31st of July. Okay, I'm going to start off by introducing the top table as I normally do. We've got a little bit of a seating rearrangement at the moment. So if I start off at the far right, we have Mrs. Condliffe, Mr. Williamson, Mr. Scott, and Mr. Smith. And then if we move to my left, we have Mr. Elliott, Councillor Braun, and Mr. Williams. Okay, do we have any declarations of interest on the proceedings today? No? Okay. Yeah. Do we have any substitutes?
Thanks, Convener. Councillor Dugan substituting for Councillor Anderson.
Councillor Dugan, thank you very much and welcome to the committee. Okay, committee, can I ask, are we happy to listen to deputations on the proceedings before us today? Okay, thank you. Danny, could you just confirm the items?
Sorry, I apologise, I didn't turn the microphone, just a note of the items, Convener.
No problem.
Yes, Councillor Wilson, we have deputations on item 521. We also have the applicant available for any questions on that, although the applicant won't be making a deputation. We have deputation on 522 and on items 523 and 524. We have the agent on behalf of the applicant is available for any questions, but again, won't be making a deputation. And also
Thank you.
Apologies, also on item 512. Again, same situation on behalf of the a representative on behalf of the applicant is available for questions, but again, won't be making a full deputation.
Thank you. Okay, so can I ask, are we in agreement of the minutes of the Planning and Development Management Committee from the 3rd of July? We're agreed. Okay. Thank you, committee. So that brings us on to today's proceedings. Okay, and we will start with the first application in front of us, which is in Ochterarder, the erection of 60 dwelling houses, landscaping and associated works, approval of matters specified in conditions of 16.1809 IPM, phase two of land at Castlemaines Farm in Ochterarder. And I would like to ask Mr. Scott to speak to the report.
Thank you very much, Convener. Before I take you through some stills, just one update for members for noting. On page 41 of your papers, paragraph 79, the fifth line refers to condition 15, where in fact it should refer to condition 14. What I'll do now is I'll take you through the proposals. What you have in front of you at the moment is the site location plan. As stated, it is in Ochterarder. It's part of the wider Ochterarder development framework, so it's had permission in place for a period of time. The application in front of you today, seeking approval of matters specified for the erection of 60 dwellings. That's a lower amount than the original 64 that's been sought. I'll touch on that in later detail. The application site is in the southwest of the screen. You see the red line area. It's the roughly rectangular shape. And to the north, there's an offshoot, which is actually the sustainable urban drainage system basin. The red line itself does extend along Castle Drive, which is the road through phase one of the Castlemaines development, up to Benton and Dunrobin Road, but there is no active development other than the road in that location, so is the layout of the housing that we're looking at. This takes us closer in, and you can see again the red light site area is identified there. So the rectilinear layout of the dwellings, Castle Drive is proposed to be brought into the development as the main and principal road, and off that there's a number of secondary streets which are of a home zone type, which is characteristic of the phase one of the Castlemaines development. The 16 dwellings in themselves, there's a mixture of detached, semi-detached, and one- and two-storey properties throughout. Just to note from this slide, you'll see on the eastern boundary, there's a junior football pitch identified. That's not within this application site area, but it is identified within the wider master plan and secured through the Section 75 agreement. And as I noted, there is a sustainable urban drainage system basin to the north. That's to serve this phase two development and likely to be serving the future development phase, which is identified on the plan there. There may be further houses coming forward to the north of this application site, but that's not part of the proposal in front of you today. taking through some stills. This is looking back at phase one from roughly the entrance to what will become phase two. So as you can see, the development's well underway. It's in fact nearing the later stages of phase one, approximately 20 dwelling houses still to be erected. But this is just to give you an impression that Castle Mains, which is the road you see in front, sorry, Castle Drive, which is the road that you see in front of you, will continue into the development. This is a reverse view of that. So again, just indicating that the main road has been formed at this point, and this is it entering the development. On the right-hand side, you can probably see just beyond the trees, there's a stat porter cabin. That's actually the site compound, which is acting for the development compound for phase one, but that will remain in situ for phase two also. This is actually a photograph taken from the first floor of that compound at the office complex. So on the left-hand side of the shot, you'll see some of the final dwellings being completed in phase one. The area of open space in front of you will become the network, sorry, the neighbourhood area of play, and also the football pitch in time. This is looking to a southwestern direction across the effect of the extent of the site that we have before us today. So in the distance, you can see houses which mark on the southern boundary. They're at Croft Road, so existing dwellings. And on the western boundary, you can see there's mature tree planting. Generally speaking, the site does slope down towards the site compound in this area. This is just a closer view within the middle of the site itself, just showing that the proposed layout would have a back-to-back arrangements with the dwelling houses that you see in front of you on the stills there on Croft Road. This is from the northern part of the site, so this isn't proposed to be developed other than the location of the suds, so it's just generally showing the location of the suds. And off the access to the site here, there is actually a core path network and other accesses, so the development will link into these areas and the wider network within Ochterarder. And this is taken from the northeast corner of the site. Looking back at phase one, so you can see again the dwelling house is completed and under construction. The compound that I referred to earlier is the blue structure within the foreground. The trees beyond, it marks the boundary of the Castle Mains, the former farmsteading, and the Schedule Monument. This is somewhat distant, about 100 metres away from that. But this just gives you a general overview of the site and topography, and indeed the outlook it's going to have beyond Ochterarder. And this is taking you back to the site location plan.
Thank you, Mr. Scott. I will open up for questions to officers. Do we have any questions? Councillor Wilson, thank you.
Thanks, Convener. I think I'm on the very first page of the report, page 27, and paragraph 2. It's about road access, my point. I'm reasonably familiar with some of the road system in the area, but not totally. Is there an assumption in this report that a lot of the traffic will go along, what is that, if we could call that, zigzag route, which is Castle Mains?
Castle Drive.
Castle Drive, right. Okay. And will then either have the option to go along what I call the new road that links into Benton Road, mm-hmm. right, or we'll go down
Hunter Street.
Yeah. Right. What analysis has been done of what the likely routes of traffic will be? Because Hunter Street's already, as Councillor Gray will be able to attest to, pretty busy and pretty congested, right? What analysis has been done of where the traffic's going to go, and what measures are in place to make sure that there's a dissipation of traffic rather than just everybody turns right into Hunter Street to take the fastest route into the High Street in Ochterarder?
Yeah, so as I alluded to, this is one site of the wider framework of sites. So giving planning permission in principle, that was considered in terms of the scale and the impact on the roads at that point. And you're correct, where Castle Drive comes out onto Benton Road, it is necessary for that new spine road to come in through the other development, which has been undertaken by Stuart Mill. So it has been considered, and that's why that road connecting from the top of Hunter Street to the Fuse is necessary. And as referred to in this report, there is a condition on the latest approval of matter specified and condition for that Stuart Mill development to deliver the timing of that road, which would actually be commensurate with this development coming forward. So there will be a choice of options. I suspect the majority of people, if they're exiting Ochterarder to the north, will use the new road, and that will take off a lot of the pressure on Hunter Street.
Thank you. That's fine for the theory. I'm more interested in what studies we've carried out
to see what the practicalities are going to be about traffic movement, because you're quite correct, if somebody's heading for Perth from this new development, they're going to go along Benton Road and then left and towards Abriven and to Perth. But the reality is a lot of journeys, and I don't know what analysis would be likely, would be that people will want to go to down the town after Ardor, right? And that will mean they'll turn right into Under Street, which is already busy. So have we done any analysis about that? And are we taking any measures to try and encourage or discourage folk from using Hunter Street as opposed to elsewhere? That's really what the core of my question is.
I will. Mr. Scott and also Mr. Salmon. Mr. Salmon, would you like to express?
Good morning, committee. In terms of assessment, we've used industry standard gravity modelling, which to explain that is essentially where we've used census data for the postcode area of Orkdon Ardor, so you can determine origin and destination trips. So that assessment was carried out, which found essentially that around a third of all traffic generated from this development and existing traffic on Hunter Street coming southbound from beyond Orkdon Ardor would use the new spine road essentially and come off. So that would help reduce the traffic burden on Hunter Street.
I'm grateful for the plain English version of that answer, thank you. Does that mean then that two-thirds of the traffic that's generated from this development will use Hunter Street?
Correct, yes.
Right, so we're adding a substantial amount of traffic to there. I mean, I, convener, have a concern about that, but I'll address that later. Yeah, I didn't answer to my question, thank you.
Thank you. Do we have any further questions for officers? No, okay, thank you. Do we have any comments on the paper? No? Okay. Well, Councillor Wilson.
Well,
I was just going to move the paper.
I'm not going to move the paper. Somebody else can do that. I have a concern that we already have a street in Achter Ardor that's heavily used. It's becoming increasingly heavily used. And here we're giving a consent to housing development, which I've no problem with in principle because it's in the local plan, that's going to put two-thirds of it traffic on a modelling system that's, I think, is a general modelling system rather than particular to the site, that two-thirds of that traffic will be using Hunter Street for access to and from the town centre. And I just have a concern about that, and I think it would be wrong for me to go through the meeting and not express that concern, because I think it's already congested and there's already parking there, which helps of course in traffic control. And I wonder if we've heard the comments on it, but from a road safety point of view, is that acceptable? Is my question really. That's another question.
It's another question.
I'm phrasing it as a comment. You can treat it as such, convener.
Okay, well, that, if it is a comment, then that is duly noted. Thank you very much indeed. Do you, Councillor Gray?
Relief to Councillor Wilson that on Monday morning there will be a town bus now operating in Orkdon Ardor. It will go up Castle Drive, it will go around Benton Road, it will go around the town, it will go all over the town. It will serve three times the hospital, visit the hospital three times every hour, every day, except Sundays or Christmas and New Year. And this is all designed to greatly relieve congestion in the middle of town and greatly diminish the need to actually take your car to the town. You will also note that the development here is actually very much adjacent to the village school, the town school. There are accesses from that development through to the school and thereby through to the town centre. So really, those who need to take the car to the town centre are in a distinct minority from Monday onwards. And I'm very happy to move the paper on that basis, if that's the only complaint.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Do we have a seconder? Councillor Drysdale.
Yes, convener. I endorse Councillor Gray's comments and I'm happy to second the paper.
Do we have an amendment? No? Then in that case, the application is approved. Thank you very much indeed. Okay, thank you, committee. So we will move on to the next application in front of us. This is in Amund Bank. That's application under section 42 of the Town and Country Planning Scotland Act in 1997 to modify conditions 2 for expiry, 3 for phasing, and 17 for extraction rate, and 28 for noise of planning permission of 98 00710, winning and working of materials at Lonleven Quarry in Amund Bank. And I would ask Mrs. Condliffe to speak to the report.
Thank you, Convener. Just before I talk to the slides, just to let members know, you all got an updated conditions, which were, I think, emailed out and in the pigeonhole. If anybody doesn't have a copy, I think Mr. Williams has a copy.
Does anybody need a copy? No. Oh, good. Thank you.
Okay. This first slide shows the waste management plan, which is the layout of the site. Now, the quarry entrance is at the far left of the screen, and that comes from the A85, and it's about a kilometre from the A85 to that point. And then just working through the site, your first area has the offices, the weighbridge, has the stockpiled area, then you pass the Meath and Lough, and then you'll see that yellow line which links the two sort of ready colours that you see on the screen. That's the conveyor belt which takes all the materials from the main extraction area. Now, the main extraction area is a large red area to the right-hand side of the screen. And then the proposal that we're looking to amend the conditions on is for the area still to be extracted, which is to the south of that red area and partly to the west. This is a very recent aerial shot that was taken of the site. Unfortunately, the orientation is slightly different from the first. But if you look at the top of the screen, that was the entrance to the site. That's the processing area linking down through past Meath and Lough that you see there and to the extraction area. And then the area that's still to be extracted then goes to the left of the screen in a southerly direction. This is the access point on the A85 between Amund Bank and Methven. And as I say, from this point to the entrance to the site, it's approximately a kilometre. I'm just going to show the slides as we go through these different areas that I showed on the first one. This is just outside the offices and the weighbridge area, and this is a stockpile area for all the materials once they've come from the site. And this is a processing plant. So this is the opposite end from that stockpile area. So towards the left of the screen, you can see the stockpile area, the processing plant. And just at the right-hand side, that's the conveyor belt that I referred to that was yellow on that first screen. And this runs for about 380 metres to the extraction area, and all the material comes along there rather than along the road to the processing plant. This is a large extraction area that we saw both on the first slide in the red and on the aerial photograph. This has all been extracted. This is virtually at the depth that will be required. And then the area is to the right of the screen, which is the area that we saw has still to be extracted. And this is the area. So this is the top end. And just as you'll see right across the screen there is the top of the bank, and the area will move in that southerly direction down towards the 85, but still retaining the very large landscaped area buffer between the extraction area and the A85. And we're back now to the waste management plan that you saw at the start of the slides. Thank you.
Thank you, Mrs. Conliffe. Now, I believe Mr. Murphy is here for any questions. Is that correct? Thank you. Sir, do you want to come over just in case there are any? I don't know if there are going to be, but I think it would be sensible if you come forward. If you just go to the podium there, and that gives you a microphone if required. So you're not here to make a deputation today, but if there are any questions on the application from an applicant point of view, I'm opening that up to the committee. Do you have any questions? Councillor Wilson.
Thanks. Good morning. This is a working site already, obviously.
Yes.
Can you remind me just how long it's been a working site?
I believe the site's been in operation for...
Sorry, how many years? 30 years, okay. And, I mean, I have a concern about water courses. I'm not sure where the the water source is for the washing and screening plant. Could you tell us where the water comes from for that?
Yes, most of the water is captured from surface water which falls on the site. It's a large area that we capture, and you can't see it on the plan, but where the processing area is, there are several lagoons where we capture the water, surface water, and we recycle that water through the washing process and recapture the water.
Okay, so once it's used, and this is in the report, it's recycled again and reused.
Yes,
so it's topped up by natural means.
From the sky, yeah. Which
what steps are in place now and in the future, given that this is an extension of time, basically,
yes,
to protect the Methven Loch, I think it is, Convener, because it's very close.
Yes, I mean, through all the reports that we had, you know, the environmental impact assessment, a lot of separate individual third-party reports were carried out, and those state that the lock would not be would be protected and would not be in any more peril than the current permissions that have been granted.
That's, again, as I said earlier, that's the theory, but in the practice, have there been any problems over the last 30 years?
Not that I'm aware. We work very closely with the landowner. We don't own the land, obviously. We lease the land to process the material. We have a good working relationship with the farmer and the landowner.
My final question, Convener, is obviously there's a reinstatement programme for here. Is topsoil stored on site and then reused again? Is that what happens?
You're quite right, and part of the removal, the strip of the topsoil to access the sand and gravel below. Part of that is used for bunding and screening. I think extra conditions have been put in with this one to create an extension of that bunding and screening further down to protect the farm.
Okay, and ultimately it'll all go back to farmland, is that the plan?
Yes, it's a full restoration plan has been submitted and was at the beginning of the quarry. That has been amended and improved, I believe, as stated in the report.
And this application, in essence, is to extend the extraction time and amount, basically, on the same principles as you've operated previously.
Exactly the same. The benefits really being the development of Perth, as you'll well know, has kicked on a bit. So we've found ourselves coming very close to our current abstraction limit annually, and we've observed that. And we can see the further development of Perth and having a local sand and gravel quarry for that development being beneficial. So we've asked for an extension in the amount per annum we could extract. However, things are very variable, and therefore we're well aware that on our previous extraction rate, the time that we have would mean that we wouldn't be able to extract all the material that's been permitted. So that's the extension of time.
Thank you. Interesting, the effects of glaciation, Convener.
Thank you. Do we have any further questions for Mr. Murphy? No? Mr. Murphy, thank you very much indeed for your attendance today, and thank you for that. And I'll now open up to committee for questions to officers. Do we have any questions? Councillor Simpson.
Thank you, Convener. A note on page 64, item 67, that transport planning did not respond to this. Are we to understand from that they just didn't bother, we just didn't feel the need to respond, or that they have no objection, given there's going to be, as I understand it, a considerable number of extra vehicle movements?
Mr. Salmon, would you like to respond? Oh, okay. Mrs. Condliffe, then.
Yeah, I'll take that one. It's because the access is onto the A85, so that's a trunk road, so it was Transport Scotland who were the main consultee for that, and the comments we received from Transport Scotland were positive.
Any further questions, committee? Councillor Wilson?
In page 66 and paras 80 and 81, just to aid my understanding, the quarry void, what does that mean, the bit that's been extracted? What does void mean in this context?
Yeah, that's the area that's already been extracted.
Already been?
Yes.
But not reinstated?
That's correct, yes. Right. Work on the reinstatement of the current extracted area before they'll move, as they move across into the new area.
Right. And just to follow on from that, convener, I mean, we've heard from the applicant's agent that things have been jogging along fine for 30 years. Is that the view of officers as far as the planning authority is concerned?
Yes, it is. This is not a site that either ourselves or Environmental Health have had any issues with. We haven't had complaints about noise, about dust, about traffic. It's a site that has been operating, as the gentleman just said, for some considerable time, and there have been no concerns from our side of things.
Okay, and finally, convener, are we content that the limited number of dwellings that are fairly near the site will not suffer any undue loss of amenity because of this extension?
Yes, we are satisfied with all the studies that we've had, and as I say, we have looked at it very closely, particularly with Environmental Health, regarding both noise and dust, and we're satisfied that it's all acceptable for the existing residential properties.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Okay, is that last question? Okay, thank you, committee. I'll ask if there are any comments, or do we have a motion? Well, I'm happy to move the paper with the amended conditions that were sent out. Sorry, Councillor Jim. Okay, we have a motion and a second. Do we have any amendment to the application? No. In that case, the application is approved. Thank you. Okay, committee, that brings us on to the next application in front of us. And that is Gilton, alterations to vehicle access, a revised design on land north of Hall Road in Gilton. And I would like to ask Mr. Scott to speak to the report.
Thank you, convener. Yes, planning permission has been sought for the installation of a road. The red line site boundary that you see in front of you is within the southern area of Gilton. It's on Hall Road and would be effectively an extension of Hall Road, which in itself is one of the primary accesses in Gilton off the main road A93, which is the main road running north to south on the plan in front of you. Taking you to the proposal, the red line site boundary on the left-hand side, so on the west, up to that point, that forms the extent of the adopted portion of Hall Road. From that point, moving in easterly direction would be a brand new road, which would be ultimately to serve a residential development which already has permission. You can see the layout on the right-hand side of shot. So to the west, you can see the Suds Basin. There's a pumping station, and the layout of the dwellings is shown there. The road as proposed would be a single track road predominantly. So at Hall Road, it would be a width of 5.5 metres. That would carry on until roughly the property you see, Braemar Cottage, at which point you'll see it tapers in to a width of 3.7 metres and thereafter continues in an eastward direction up to the site boundary, so adjacent to the Suds Basin, where again it would increase back up to a full width of 5.5 metres. The proposal is being sought in response to mitigating potential effects of flooding from the burn, which is located to the immediate south of the site. You can probably just see it tapering off to in the southwestern direction. So in addition to the road itself, there's going to be a footpath formed on the northern portion of the road, which would be 1.8 metres wide, which would serve connection from the residential development along Hall Road to the services within the village and the bus stops that are on the A93. And on the southern portion of the narrowed road, there would also be a 1 metre grass verge, which would be a further buffer with the burn. This is the first slide I'll show in terms of the location. So this is taken from the A93. This is Main Road, looking down Hall Road. You can see in the distance there is a car and trees. That's actually at the point where there's a non-adopted portion of Hall Road. I'll come onto that in a bit more detail. But this is just to give you the context of the good access and visibility onto Hall Road itself. This is the hall, clearly, as you can see, on Hall Road. This does not form part of the application site, but it's just to point out that the extent of the adopted portion of the road actually almost ends on the right-hand side of the shot. So to the east, where the gable of the hall is, that's the end point of where the adopted portion of the road is. So the proposal in front of you doesn't affect the road or the hall's curtilage in any way. This is taken from that point off the end gable of the hall. So as I've said, this is the extent of the adopted portion, and you can see from this point onwards, it's an unadopted road in private ownership. You can see it is to an extent here topped with a hardcore, but it isn't an adopted road at the moment. It does primarily serve the three cottages you see on the left-hand side, and there's a further dwelling on the right-hand side of this shot. This is taken from where the road, if you like, of the private road actually ends. So the proposed road would continue from this point on. This is the property to the left-hand side here is Lindale. So this is the last of the three cottages on the north-hand side of the road. So the proposed road would continue in an eastward direction through where the mown path you see on towards the tree area in the distance. This is just taking you slightly further forward. This is the recreational ground. So again, this is on the other side of Lindale, and the road would continue in this eastward direction. The tree area and where the kind of rough grazing and grass is, that's actually the field in which the residential development would take place and that this road is proposed to serve. And this is just a view from the opposite direction looking back at Hall Road. So you see the gable end there of the property known as Lindale. And Hall Road would continue from this point back up to meet the connected portion. And I said it'd be 5.5 metres wide at that point. It tapers down before it reconnects with the adopted portion of Hall Road. And this takes you back to the site location plan.
Thank you, Mr. Scott. Okay, we have Councillor Stewart, who's here to make a deputation. Thank you, Councillor. You have 5 minutes to address the committee. At the end of the 5 minutes, are you happy to take questions? You will be given notification when there's a minute left to go. So, anytime we start. Thank you.
Thank you, Convener. I'm grateful to the committee for agreeing to hear me today as a local elected member. And I've come to represent the views of constituents, particularly those residents of the property Lindale, one of the three properties in front of which it's proposed to narrow the road. I'd like to address three main issues, chiefly the residential amenity of the properties, but also the road traffic safety concerns appropriately expressed by Gilton Community Association, and thirdly, the timing of the development. Firstly, in respect of amenity, residents have concerns about the ability of visitors to access their properties. At present, residents are used to parking on Hall Road, and the report recognises that they do have the ability to use off-street parking for themselves. However, the proposed narrowing of the road would limit access for visiting friends, family, for delivery vehicles, for GPs, health visitors, caregivers, etc., and for ambulances, of which there have had to be a number of visits, unfortunately, in the last couple of years. It must be emphasised that the residents I speak for are not opposed to the principle of the residential development. They've accepted this, nor to the visual amenity of having a road in front of their property. But in terms of the residential amenity of all properties along Hall Road and in the new development, the amenity of only these three properties will be affected in terms of their use of what I am advised will become an adopted public road. In terms of the report, at paragraph 46, visual amenity is dealt with, but policy PM1A in section 19 does not specify only visual amenity. In terms of paragraph 48 of your the reports in front of you, the consideration in relation to existing residential amenity from policy RD1 is directed at air pollution and idling vehicle noise, etc., but doesn't directly address the issues of access and use of a public road, as I've outlined. Turning secondly to the concerns of Gilton Community Association regarding road traffic safety, those are legitimate concerns, and narrowing of the road would be likely to slow traffic, but other options for slowing traffic would also be possible, including if the road narrowing was moved further to the east. And that leads me on to my third point, which is in regard to timing of this development. You will note from the report that the proposed access to the Northfield housing development has been moved from Hall Road up to the north of Northfield Road. There will be a build-out rate over a number of years, and there is time for further consideration to be given to the appropriate development of the access to the south of the development at Hall Road. The report recognises that there are construction difficulties with the existing Cambus Lang burn, but these are surely not insurmountable in this day and age. Thank you.
Okay, thank you. I'll open up to questions. Do we have any questions for Councillor Stewart? Councillor Wilson.
Thanks, Convener. Morning, Councillor Stewart. You mentioned 3 points. The first one was residential amenity. Now, you've acknowledged that yourself and the folk you're representing today didn't have a problem, and will at least have become resolved to the fact there'll be a housing development here. What were your views and the residents' views on what was the original proposal for a road, which was a 5 metre road that would simply go past the houses without any narrowing?
Oh, sorry, I should have explained that. The residents that I'm speaking on behalf of would prefer the wider 5 metre road as originally consented in order to provide the space for vehicles and allow those properties to use the road in the same manner as I said, every other property on Hall Road and in the new development would be able to use to occasionally receive deliveries outside their properties or visits from friends, family, caregivers, GPs if necessary. So they would prefer the wider solution as originally consented. And recognising that there are, however, difficulties with the potential construction of that, that's why I've said about the timing and that there is time to, in this day and age, come forward with a construction solution.
Okay, I'll come to the point in timing in a moment, just dealing with the amenity issue, right? You've indicated that the people would be happy with the normal width of 5 metre road. What would be the advantages of the width of that road then for the residents involved? Because there's 3 or 4 houses involved here.
It is about access to the properties. So if the road is narrowed in front of their properties, anybody trying to stop at them will either have to stop a considerable distance away, or they will have to pull up onto the pavement. And we know that pulling up onto pavements and blocking pavements and stuff is increasingly antisocial. Thank you, Councillor Dugan, was exactly the word I was looking for. So for those occasions when they do require deliveries, visits, etc., then the ability to use what will become a public road in the same way as all other residences is I think all they're asking for.
Okay. You mentioned in your submission that one solution might be to move the narrow bit up a bit, or I don't think that was your exact words, but I think that was the implication. Did I get that right?
Yes, if narrowing of the road was to be the solution to traffic concerns, then the narrowing of the road could happen further east. If there were other methods of slowing the traffic in recognition of the concerns that I think you're about to hear from Gilton Community Association in terms of vehicles driving past the hall, which is used by a number of community groups, there are other potential traffic mitigation and slowing down measures that could be used.
Okay. And going on to that, the community association who run the hall, I believe, okay, presumably they're an organisation that represents the community in Gilton, are they?
My understanding is that they run the village hall, which also, the hall on Hall Road.
Okay. And you've said there's a road safety issue, but you didn't elaborate on that.
So my understanding from reading the, I wasn't able to immediately find it online. I think it was the case officer indicated to me it had been a late submission from Gilton Community Association in relation to this development. But they're concerned, I think, about the, if there is an access provided to the residential development along Hall Road, and there are elderly and young families. I'm not sure of all of the different groups that use the village hall on Hall Road, but the traffic going along there, if it was allowed to be two-way, would be faster, and that they see the narrowing of the road as an acceptable, from reading the report, they see the narrowing of the road as a way of slowing down that traffic. My point is that if it's going to become an adopted public road, there are other ways of slowing down the traffic rather than having to narrow it in front of these three particular properties.
So are you agreeing with, I'm not sure now if you're agreeing with the view of the community association or not?
I'm saying that they have got a legitimate concern. I'm saying right. that there are other potential solutions rather than
okay.
rather than the narrowing of the road in front of those three particular problems.
Finally, Convener, just going on to your point about the new access, I mean, are you suggesting that any decision on this application should be deferred or refused in order to allow further thought to be given to the alternatives? You didn't quite articulate what you meant by saying, well, give us time to think about how the new access would be delivered and used, right? And I'm aware of the proposals for the alternative access to the, is it the north of the site? Northfield Road. Northfield Road, right? So are you suggesting that the committee might consider either a deferral or a refusal?
I'm not entirely sure. I don't come along to Planning and Development Management Committee very often. I'm not entirely sure of what your appropriate response is, whether it is deferral or refusal. Were you to refuse it, there is a consented planning application there for the construction of a road to the south to provide access into the development. If the developer wished to come back within a certain period of time with an alternative proposal, my point, I think, is that the in terms of the policies which apply, for which consideration has to be given, policies RD1 and PM1A, the existing residential amenity of the properties has been dealt with in terms of visual amenity, road vehicle idling, noise, traffic pollution, but not in terms of the amenity that's been the residential of the amenity of the properties that has been expressed to me by the residents. So in terms of the detail that's in the report, it's a matter for the committee whether you would seek to defer, refuse, do a site visit, okay. whatever. That's beyond my ken, I'm afraid.
I understand that, but if we are to propose either a deferral or a refusal, we've got to give reasons, and I'm looking for you articulating the reasons why we might consider that. If that's what you're suggesting,
I think in that case it is just what I've said. It's policies RD1 and policy PM1A in terms of the residential amenity of those properties.
Thank you.
Councillor Waters, do you have a question?
Thank you, Convener. Just looking for some local information, especially on Lindale and Braemar. Do they have driveways? And I notice at the end of these three cottages, there's three garages sitting on the map. But do these two properties have a driveway? Do you know?
Yes, they do. They've got off-street parking. That's recognised in the report. And I said in my comments that, you know, the report recognises that they have the residents themselves have the ability to park off-street. The concern that was expressed to me was about visitors to the visiting vehicles to the properties.
Thank you.
Can I ask Councillor Barnacle, certainly.
Again, Colin, I'm looking for a bit of local knowledge here. Northfield Road compared with Hall Road, which has been secured as a second vehicular access since the application was approved. Is that a better access, in your opinion, than Hall Road? or does it have similar problems? Is it a better access? And would, in fact, in hindsight, that access have been the preferred route into the development?
Northfield Road is a quiet residential. Essentially, it's a cul-de-sac, or it's a you know, there are, Northfield Road doesn't go anywhere. It comes back, and if I recall correctly, it loops on itself. There's very often traffic parked outside properties on Northfield Road. I think only some properties there, if I recall correctly, only some properties there have off-street parking. But it is an existing adopted public road, which is wider than Hall Road, and it doesn't have a public building used by members of the community like the village hall on Hall Road.
Certainly.
You say it doesn't go anywhere. What do you mean by that?
I mean that if you go onto Northfield Road, you would eventually come back out at the same. It doesn't go through to anywhere. It will go through to somewhere. It will go through to the housing development, but it doesn't. It is not currently a through road to anywhere else. It comes. If I recall correctly, it does a sort of loop round, and there's maybe another couple of cul-de-sacs off it, but it's not a through road to anywhere.
It's not an
currently.
Access into Guildtown centre.
No, so absolutely not.
That's what I was trying to establish.
Sorry, it's not an access. No.
Okay, thank you. Do we have any further questions for Councillor Stewart? Councillor Stewart, thank you very much for your time this morning. I appreciate that. Thank you.
I appreciate that as well. Thank you, convener.
Okay, so I now open up for questions to officers. Do we have any questions? Councillor Gray.
Thank you, convener. Councillor Stewart alluded to the...
I apologise. I've jumped ahead of myself. I do apologise. If you could hold on to your question for a little bit longer. if you could hold on to your question for a little bit longer. Yes, we also have Mr. Stephen here, who's the applicant, who's available for any questions, and that should take priority over officers. So my apologies, gentlemen. Mr. Stephen, if you are available for questions, I will open it up to the committee. Do we have any questions for Mr. Stephen? Councillor Gray.
Okay, the same question to Mr. Stephen, thank you. Councillor Stewart alluded to the fact that there were difficulties in bridging this burn, or in the vicinity of this burn, hence the need to reduce the width of the road. Is this correct?
Yes, and it might be useful if I could explain a little bit of the history behind this, which Councillor Stewart and indeed the residents of Lindale are not aware of, and therefore may change their outlook on why we are seeking to narrow the road. We have a consent for about 80 houses at the moment at Guildtown. In March of last year, we were about to go on site and start work on the development. But in order to do so, we've got to apply to SEPA for what's called a CAR licence, Controlled Activity Register licence, which seeks to ensure that the quality of the water environment is not adversely affected. And by that means the water quality in the Gambas Michael Burn. At that meeting, it became evident that SEPA were unaware that we had planning consent for the development that was granted in 2011. They had concerns over the narrowing of the watercourse at that point, given the change in regulations associated with flooding. Now, whilst A&J Stephen were quite within their rights to go ahead and construct that road, we felt we would do the right thing and go back to the drawing board and seek to come up with a solution that addressed the new, more stringent conditions. And that's what we did. We went away, we got consent, approval with the Roads Department for an amended solution in March of last year. We then sought confirmation from SEPA that they were comfortable with that solution. Unfortunately, they didn't respond to that. We then submitted our planning application, and we are now in a position where SEPA are content. So the reason behind this is not a technical issue associated with how do you construct it. What we were trying to do was ensure that the now current regulations over flooding were addressed, despite the fact we didn't have to do so. The unfortunate thing is we now find ourselves 15 months later. We've not been on site for that length of time. It's held up 20 affordable houses. We can't get started. We've got a contract with Caledonia Housing Association. So in seeking to do the right thing, we've actually been held up. So that is the reason why we're here today. It's nothing to do with a technical construction issue. It's we are seeking to do the right thing and address a theoretical flooding issue due to a change in regulations between the date of the original consent and where we are now.
Thank you for that, Mr. Stephen. I'm still a wee bit puzzled as to why the width of the road needs to be narrowed in the vicinity of the burn.
Okay, well, if you look at the plan that's on the board in front of you, on the screen in front of you, the road runs parallel to the watercourse. If the road was constructed at its consented width, it would impact on the channel. Therefore, by narrowing the road, we're pulling the road away from the watercourse and it does not have an impact on the watercourse.
Is there any possibility of averting the watercourse up further from what would be a new road?
No.
Can you tell me why?
Well, we don't own the land. It's not within our gift to do so.
Okay, thank you.
Councillor Dugan.
Thank you, Convener. Thank you, Mr. Stephen. I was going down Councillor Gray's line of questioning there as well. So you don't own the land, so that's a non-starter. What about culverting? Is that not a technical solution?
No, SEPA would not. They discourage that very strongly. Right, okay, they don't want to do that.
Any further questions for Mr. Stephen? Councillor Wilson. Thank you.
Thanks, Convener. Good morning, Mr. Stephen. Good
morning.
The issue about the delay that you've raised, right? Mm-hmm. You have an alternative access to the site.
That's correct.
Yes. And you could. Is there any technical or planning reason why you can't proceed with that?
It's a financial reason. The site has to be proved to be viable in its entirety. So we need both accesses. Otherwise, we've got to apply for consent to redo the whole thing. And that puts us back another 2 or 3 years. And as I say, there's 20 affordable houses that should have been built by now, but haven't been.
Okay, so in order to get the financial package put together, you need a consent for both accesses. Is
yes.
that what you're saying?
Yes.
Right? Okay. The Councillor Stewart has mentioned moving the narrow bit up a bit, right? Put it in, I think, his terms. Is that technically feasible from your perspective?
I suppose it could be done, but it still leaves us with the problem that SEPA wouldn't be happy about the narrowing of the burn.
Yeah, so that would involve...
Well, if you move the narrowing section, the reason the narrowing is where it is because that's the point at which the road is adjacent to the watercourse. So if we move the narrowing away from the watercourse, you're not addressing SEPA's concern.
Right. I think I understand that.
Well, when I say move it away, if you move it laterally along the length of the burn into the development, yeah. The purpose of the narrowing is to address SEPA's concerns. Okay. By coincidence, it also creates a traffic calming measurement, a traffic calming improvement, which the Roads Department are keen to see as well. So by moving the narrowing point, you would still have the traffic calming benefit, although I would imagine, it wouldn't serve the same purpose. It wouldn't be as advantageous in another location because it's a straight length of road past the hall and along past the three houses. It's that long length of road that can encourage high vehicle speeds. If you narrow that, you would reduce the vehicle speeds. So it's serving two functions. It's the traffic calming and addressing SEPA's concerns. So if you move the location of the narrowing, you wouldn't achieve either of those.
Right. Just on that, since you've kind of opened up the traffic calming issue again, mm-hmm. was there any proposals for the 5-metre road originally applied for and consented for traffic calming?
No.
No. So somewhere out of the ether of this discussion has come an issue that wasn't addressed previously in the consent but has now been addressed.
Or regulations have changed, which is often the case with the passage of time.
Maybe, right? Is there an option for you simply to go ahead with your original consent and say to SEPA, well, we understand what your concerns are, but we'll introduce suitable mitigation to address these?
Are you suggesting that we increase the likelihood of flooding and gilting?
No. What I'm suggesting is, I'm asking you the question, because you said earlier on it was technically feasible to do what you could do, but you...
The road could be constructed,
yeah, right,
but you would then not comply with the current regulations on flooding.
Right, okay. Right. It was not just a matter of the SEPA comments on the but because of the changes in their regulations, you would run a higher risk of flooding.
Higher. I mean, the extent of flooding is minimal anyway. It's a theoretical risk. It's a very, very small difference. But nevertheless, SEPA were not happy.
Okay, right. Fine. Thank you.
Thank you. Councillor Brown.
Good morning, Mr. Stephen. Just a quick
morning.
Point. You mentioned there would be two access routes into the site. Will one of them be a predominant access site, or will it be equal? I'm trying to think, would this be the secondary access point, or will they be classed as equal? I'm presuming the elements through Northfield Road, is that going to be the access point?
That's correct, yes. Yeah.
So would that be the sort of the main entrance to it, if you like to put it that way?
I would imagine that it would depend, the use of the road would depend on where the resident lives within the development.
Yeah.
So if you're closer to Northfield, you use the Northfield. If you're closer to the Hall Road, you would use Hall Road. Mm. So it will vary depending on the location of the resident.
Okay. I'm just on the line, I'm thinking of Councillor Stewart brought up the question of some form of emergency vehicle, like a fire engine or an ambulance, would block that road, and presumably could then go back out the other route, obviously.
Yes.
Yeah. Okay, thank you.
Okay, Councillor Simpson.
Thank you, Convener. Morning, Mr. Stephen.
Morning.
I think we recognise how important this consent is to the getting on with the rest of the housing, which my understanding from Gilton is people would be quite happy if you were to do that. I just wondered if AMG's even took the opportunity to consult with any of the residents in Hall Road before putting forward this proposal. I know you didn't have to, but did you give any consideration to that, given the Hall couldn't be handier, you know?
Well, we actually felt that what we were proposing would be a benefit to them, given SEPA's concerns.
Yeah, I recognise that. I just wonder, there has not been any...
No, there's been no direct contact between us and the residents of Hall Road.
Thank you. Councillor Waters?
Yeah, thank you. Hello, Mr. Stephen. Just the second access into the site, the width of that road, will that be a 5 metre width road?
I think it's 5.5.
5.5, so full width road coming on two
cars. Don't take that as gospel, because I haven't measured it, but I think it's of that order.
Right, thank you.
Okay. Thank you. Do we have any further questions for Mr. Stephen? Councillor James, it's fine.
Sorry, Convener. Mr. Stephen, bearing in mind you've permission for 24 houses, the narrowing of that road from 5 to 3.7, what effect will that have on HGVs delivering to the site?
Well, the narrowed road is sufficient, is designed, in fact, we're required to design it in that way for a fire engine. So HGVs can get into the site, there's not an issue there. The width of the road is designed to accommodate that, the narrowed road.
And again, committee, do we have any further questions? No. Mr. Stephen, thank you very much for your attendance today, and thank you for answering the questions.
Thank you.
Okay. And we will now move on to where I was so swiftly getting before and open up to questions for officers. Do we have any questions for officers? No. Councillor Dugan, thank you.
Thank you, Convener. I'm just trying to find the right paragraph. I know it to be paragraph 45, however, and it details the situation as regards Hall Road being used, ironically, as a Hall Road, and I think residents would be, as in H-A-U-L, residents would be pleased to note that the intended build programme is to the north, which would negate the need to use Hall Road as a construction Hall Road. My concern, following on from Councillor James's final question there to Mr. Stephen, is how that relates to the condition, which I think is condition 3, which says that there will need to be dialogue. I'm not quoting directly. There'll need to be dialogue about the plan for construction traffic. Is it competent for officers to condition the developer to have only light goods vehicles accessing the site? Because we can talk about accessing the site, which is a construction site, or we can talk about access to the development, which is a place that people live. Now, during the construction phase, there's obviously a lot of HGV movement. My concern would be that that would be passing very, very immediately in front of these properties. But I wouldn't like to limit construction access for the developer for light goods vehicles, etc., of which will also be a high volume. It just seems to me to be reasonable compromise to say that, yes, both accesses are suitable for construction traffic, but only the other access, i.e. not Hall Road, is suitable for HGVs. Is that a reasonable condition that we can attach?
Mr. Scott?
I think condition three, in the fullness of what we're to consider in terms of the construction traffic, what's going to go where and when, starting from the north at Northfield Road, we will consider those very impacts. I don't think it would get to the point of restricting particular vehicles, but the routes and timing and phasing of construction will come off Northfield Road, and that will be the predominant access. So it is within our control to agree when Hall Road is connected up to, and in effect limiting the use of that road for the predominantly use for construction vehicles, but not specifically to the type of vehicles, but there is sufficient control, I believe, within that condition.
Thank you, Convener. I accept what was said about the material content of the of this particular application, but it's helpful, I think, maybe to put that marker down.
Thank you. Councillor Waters, you were next. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Convener. Just to go back to Mr. Stephen, chatted quite a bit about the flooding risks, and I understand that, you know, SEPA have no problems with the flooding risks with this application, which is obviously a narrower road. And in relation to the initial application for the 5 metre wide road, we were informed that it doesn't meet with the current standards for flooding and may increase the risk of flooding in the area. Have we got somebody from the flooding team or somebody that can comment on that and give some more information?
We don't have anybody from the flooding team, unfortunately, due to availability, but I'm happy to answer any questions in terms of flooding. So Mr. Stevens is correct, that permission was granted for the full width of the two-way road, if you like, at that point. It was at the point of trying to implement that permission that it came to light that that road would have an impact on the likelihood of flooding in that area and indeed the properties along Hall Road. So the alternative scheme that we have in front of us in itself does have a potential for an impact on flooding, even with the narrower road. So studies have been undertaken to show that effectively an offset area, so a compensatory storage area, would need to be formed to actually minimise and mitigate against that risk. So it's 14 cubic metres of soil is effectively being removed. So on the plan that's in front of you at the moment, you can see on the east side there's a kind of box area which says pumping station. To the south and east of that, you'll see this hatching that marks like there's a slope going down. What's actually happened is the applicant within that area of landscaping is removing that volume of 14 cubic metres to provide the necessary storage for flooding. So the road will no longer have an impact. That proposal has been secured through the permission, the condition on that permission for levels. So we are delivering the compensatory storage through the wider permission, which would tailor for the impacts that would arise from this road.
Councillor Wilson.
Thanks, Convener. I'm afraid I've forgotten the detailed number of houses that are 74. On 74 extant on the application. Do we need two access roads?
Assessing the proposal that we have in front of us, at the time of granting permission for the principal permission, there was only the need for the one access road. A later development proposal came forward in the northern area off Northfield Road, which in and of itself required its own access. So we approved on the basis that that was providing access at Northfield, and we were left with a situation with two. Clearly, we're in a situation that two routes are now being proposed, albeit one is minimised. Do believe, for the purposes of connectivity and providing alternative routes to the A93, for traffic, it would actually minimise the overall impact on any given area, whether that's Northfield Road or Hall Road. In terms of amenity, there is a plurality of choice. They can go north or south depending on where they want to go, and on that basis we do consider it is acceptable, and the second access at the later stage of the development, coming forward at Hall Road is appropriate.
Okay, but originally we had only one access.
We did for a smaller scale of residential development, yes.
For a smaller scale,
two permissions on the wider site that are now in place. So at that point, for the level of development, I believe it's 63, it was Hall Road. The later development coming forward at Northfield, I forget what the number is, but increasing the numbers, it required a second access.
Okay, thank you. Convener, I want to ask about road safety, because in the report we have a page and a two pages nearly of text on road safety, and a case we made for the narrowing road being a road safety feature. I understand all of that, but we have a extant approval that gave a 5 metre road or a 5.5 metre road with no road safety measures on it at all. I'm curious to know why that has now been used as an argument for promoting the proposed change, whereas before it didn't even exist.
Mr. Salmon?
Yes. In both cases, with the original consent and with the one before us, road safety have been engaged. With the previous consented 5.5 metre, there was no issues raised from road safety, and equally with the proposal in front of us, no objection raised, but the view was that what was being offered was a betterment, and they raised no objection to that betterment.
Thank you for the reply, convener, but that doesn't answer my question. That it was previously not an issue, and it's now strongly supported in two pages of text within the report. I'm just curious to know why there has been a substantial change of mind.
I don't think there was, but continue, please, Mr. Scott.
Yeah, just to continue from what Mr. Salmon said there, we've assessed the road on its own merits and there are no road safety concerns. The point being raised about traffic calming measures came from initially the Guildhall Community Group, saying that they consider that there would be an added benefit to that providing a traffic calming measure. It's not a formal traffic calming system, but it's a benefit. So it's just that as a knock-on effect and a positive effect of the road that we've got. That alongside with the condition for the operation of the road that have a priority for traffic moving into the residential development rather than out of it, would make sure that traffic flows are moving away from the houses. These are things that add to the reasoning why the road is appropriate.
I'll let that one rest at the moment, convener.
That was better.
Thank you.
Okay. Councillor James, you had a question, and then Councillor Gray.
Thanks, convener. Mr. Scott, I'm just curious, SEPA, God bless them. If there's no plan to change the burn, as in we're not going to be filling it in, we're not going to divert it, I can't see why there's an increase in flooding by moving the road back by 1.3 metres if we're not affecting the burn. Does that? I can't understand. Can't get
it's advice. Kind of the other way around. The burn is a static position. When we approved planning permission then and now, it hasn't changed. What probably has changed is, I think Mr. Stephen alluded to it, maybe regulations, but more the understanding of the flood risks and implication from that road. So the modelling and the information they know now indicates that there's a mitigation that's needed. So the mitigation is reducing the width of the road and providing the compensatory storage. That's just with the benefit of time and more information becoming available. Flooding is a moving thing. We're getting more and more informed constantly, and SEPA update their maps to reflect that. And this is an opportunity actually to capture something that wasn't previously known, but we do know now, and that's why the solution has been proposed.
The narrowing of the road means that there is no impact on the watercourse, whereas when it was a wider road, there would have been an impact on the watercourse. Okay, Councillor Gray.
So along a similar line, thank you, convener. The sequence of events is this 5 metre road has permission. And then by further investigation, was that by us or by SEPA, established that, no, this was a bad idea. What was the sequence of events which said we will have to change this?
Yeah, again, I think Mr. Stephen touched on that. They approached SEPA for a separate regulation that they needed, a constructed activity regulation to undertake works within the vicinity of the watercourse, and it was flagged up at that point that they weren't aware of the permission. The circumstances for that, I don't know. But in effect, Stephen Holmes could build the road, but they sought to address SEPA's concerns but flagged up about flood risk. So the 5-metre-wide road would have a bigger impact on flood risk, whereas a narrower road taking up a smaller footprint is obviously a smaller impact. Mm-hmm. As I've said, there is still a degree of mitigation that's required, and that's the compensatory storage. So it was through going through another statute consenting process that this was picked up, and that's why we've got a second planning application for the road to try and resolve that issue.
Do SEPA have any responsibility in this change of circumstance?
They would be a statutory consultee for the purposes of the planning applications then and as they are now, and we've consulted them on the current proposal. And now, having confirmed the mitigation for the compensatory storage, they've confirmed they've got no objection to the proposal.
Yeah. I'm still concerned somehow or other that there still is not another way out of this by simply moving that burn. And I do understand it's somebody else's property, but who would have the responsibility should there be a desire to move the burn? Would that be the developer's responsibility or SEPA come into this?
It would probably be neither directly. I think the consequence of the development happening, the applicant here is undertaking what they can in reducing the road and providing compensated storage on the land that they control. The burn isn't being moved. That would be a wider project that SEPA might lead on, but it would be the responsibility of the landowner of the burn. So it wouldn't be appropriate to touch the burn, as it were. The solution here is to take literally a step back and allow the floodplain to be more available.
Can I just, sorry, Mr. Councillor Grave, just to sort of add to that, that we do have an application in front of us, and I'm slightly concerned we're veering into ground that doesn't belong. It's not under the developer's jurisdiction. It would be SEPA that would have to do it with the landowner. It's not in front of us today, I guess. I'm just concerned we're moving off into a different direction.
I do appreciate that point, but I'm merely trying to establish responsibility. Is it, in fact, the developer's responsibility to find the solution?
Fine.
Okay,
thank you. Do we have any further questions? Councillor Simpson.
Thank you, Convener. I have a couple of questions in relation to the amenity of the three cottages, Woodcott, Braemar and Lindale, and the suggestion that there is parking available within those properties. Normally, we're anxious to ensure if you're driving off a road that you can come in and out in forward gear. Are we to understand that that's possible with these three houses, or are they going to have to either reverse in from a narrow road in through a gateway or reverse out through a gateway into the traffic? I've been sort of over-briefed in this development. I was at the Gilton Friendship Club last Wednesday, and there wasn't a huge amount of friendship on display when discussing this, and was on the site for quite a long time with some residents, and they seemed concerned about this.
Okay, Mr. Salmon?
Yes, in regards to the existing parking facilities for the houses, they are not on the housing plots themselves, and they are existing in out width. So that is an existing situation where they are having to manoeuvre in and out of their parking area. And it's not affected by the works proposed today.
I think, are we discussing the three lockups beside Woodcut on the map and the parking in front of them?
Yeah.
Yeah, which is not adjacent to the houses. Well, it's adjacent to one house.
Yes.
So, in other words, we're suggesting that people from Lindale and Braemar's parking will be down towards the hall and not beside their house.
There is no right to park at the frontage of your home on a public road.
No, I reckon, I'm just considering the amenity. So, if they decide to park within their property, because they're talking about lowering the kerbs somewhere within the paper, is that so they can access the area around their houses, or so they can access the area further down? I mean, can they park in the garden, or are they having to park somewhere else?
I'm certainly not aware of any parking in the garden. They would need to apply for a vehicle access permission, which we would then look at and assess at the time.
Do we know if they have that at the moment?
Not to my knowledge.
Mr. Scott, you wish to address that?
Yeah, just to clarify, it wasn't probably directly shown on the stills, but I'm looking at aerial photography, and it would appear that between Lindale and Braemar, that there is a gap there that has availability, and it would appear that cars can and do indeed park in that area. So where the existing driveways do exist on Lindale, Braemar and Woodcroft, the newly formed road would have a drop curb to allow access within the cartilage. There is an additional parking area in the lockups. And beyond that, as it is available, there would be parking on Hall Road, which the adopted portion is some 50 metres away from that vicinity.
Are we content that it's acceptable to reverse out or reverse in from this narrow road?
Yes, we would be. I don't think we'd have any concern given the limited flow of traffic on that road as it will be, and indeed on the informal track as it currently stands. And as I say, there is still alternative parking available at the lockups and along Hall Road as well, which would allow you to go forward and turn around.
And also, as regards the proposed traffic calming, would it not have been more appropriate if I had further information as to what that was going to take, what people are going to have at their houses? I mean, people that live there might have been pleased to know what is actually being proposed rather than what's in the paper, which is something to our satisfaction, which is not quite the same as telling them what they're going to get right outside their house.
There isn't going to be a formal traffic calming scheme. The calming is a positive benefit from the actual layout and how the road is going to work in and of itself. That's making sure that the traffic moves away from the houses, and at the narrower point, clearly the traffic would have to move on either into the development or into the cartilages.
Yeah, I think there's a slight disconnect. Because the road is narrowing and there's a possibility that there will be cars coming in from different directions, that is the reason why there has to be mitigating controls put in place. It's the traffic calming, in effect, has happened from the fact that the road has been diminished in width.
Okay. And finally, with regards to the Cambus Michael burn, I notice that the narrowing of the road is not actually beside the burn, it's beside the drying green. Is that right, or am I misunderstanding the map?
No,
but it says Glengarry is the drying green.
The 61-metre area where the road is at a narrower width is adjacent to the north of the bank of the Cambus Michael burn, and that would be at the point where it is more likely or susceptible, where the watercourse changes route for where flooding might happen.
So just to be clear, is that the area outside Woodcote or the area outside Lindale, rather?
It's in front of Braemar Cottage. So you can see on the drawing that's up on the screen, Braemar Cottage, where the red line site boundary juts out. But at that point, the road would actually taper in. So you can see, probably quite difficult to see, the road narrows from 5 metres. Thank you. So at that point there, the road would narrow from 5 metres to 3.7 metres outside Braemar Cottage. It would carry on in an eastward direction, and then it would come back up to full width of 5.5 metres adjacent to the suds basin within the wider residential development.
Councillor Dugan.
Thank you, Convener. You're very indulgent. It's following on from Councillor Simpson's questions, and can I just seek clarity from officers that there's nothing to suggest before us today that the new road as proposed in this application, the narrow section, is any narrower than that which is there at the moment? It's just narrower than that which was originally proposed.
Yes, it's narrower than that which was proposed, and for the large extent, there isn't actually a road as such. It's a private track, and as I showed on some of the stills, just a walkway. So no, it's just narrower than the original proposal.
Councillor Barnacle.
Yeah, I'm a little confused. Following Councillor Simpson's question, paragraph 42 states the proposed new road will no longer allow parking on the existing surfaced or grassed area to the frontage of the dwelling. So that's the loss of amenity in that respect, although that is not a planning issue as such. All three directly affected properties do have off-street parking within their curtilages, and new drop curbing to allow vehicle access to each is proposed. That seems to contradict what was earlier said by Rhodes. What is the exact position?
Mr. Scott.
Yeah, from what Mr. Salmon said, it did provide further clarification. So as you've explained there, they wouldn't be able to park on the road, and that isn't a planning issue. But there are some areas that they all have in curtilage or off-street car parking, and drop curbs will be provided. So they do have some, and I think Councillor Stewart raised his concerns, but not actually about their own parking, which we accept they do have off-street car parking. It was about visitor parking, but there is also other additional parking elsewhere, which I've highlighted in terms of lock-up and along Hall Road. But all of those three residents do have within curtilage off-street parking.
Okay, do we have any final questions for officers? No, thank you, committee, for the questions. I think we have very much covered all of the ground here. So do we have any comments, or can I ask for a motion? Well, I would like to move the paper. I'd actually like to move the paper as it stands. I understand the questions and the comments that have been raised by Councillor Stewart. But as it's already been stated, the off-street parking and loss of amenity actually, in this case, isn't actually a planning issue. It is the people who live there at the moment, who are currently using this lane to park their cars, it isn't actually a right that they have to park their cars in that area. We have a development that has planning permission, and I believe that with the information that we've been given, that the application in front of us does meet with all the planning requirements that we have within the area, and I would like to move the paper. Do I have a seconder? Councillor Dugan.
I'm happy to second. After what's been quite a long debate, and I think we've tested quite a lot of the issues that have been put forward both by the developer and by Councillor Stewart on behalf of people that live in that locality, I think in terms of the representations, which identified four key issues that residents were concerned about, all of us had had an opportunity this morning to take a view on them, and I think we all of us accept that whenever a new development happens, there is an impact on people who already live in a place and enjoy that place. But from my point of view, the impact, the negative impact, such as it is, which will apply to people living in the locality here, are greatly outweighed by the opportunity to get this site up and running. And I don't see the narrowing of this road as entirely negative. One of the concerns is about traffic or increased vehicle movements. I'm hopeful that, I can't prove it, I don't necessarily know it, but I'm very hopeful that there will be in fact less vehicle movements outside these properties as a result of this narrowing, as residents choose to take the easier access and egress from their development. So I think it's been a good debate on this particular application, and I'm happy to support it.
Thank you, Councillor Dugan. Do we have an amendment? Councillor Simpson.
Thank you, Convener. Don't elapse into LRB speak, but I feel we do not have sufficient information here to make a decision. I think given the importance the developer attaches to this permission, it would have been helpful to have had more the full information from SEPA as to the actual why this road's having to be done in this way. I'm not convinced by that. And I think it would also be helpful to have the full traffic signage and whatever else we're doing for the traffic calming proposals before us, before we could decide. So I would propose we defer until such time as that information is available for our consideration. Even now that information must be available, I just feel it should have been provided. You know, it shouldn't delay things very much. You know,
I'm just checking that out. Do you have a second?
I'm just Councillor Simpson narrating down what I think the kind of amendment that you're proposing, which I think is to defer for further information on, firstly, flooding, with particular reference to SEPA's position. And secondly, the traffic calming measures. I have to say, when I heard it, I didn't think there were specific signage and traffic calming measures. The measure is the factor of that, the narrowing.
Well, paragraph 40 refers to appropriate signage and associated road markings, and that seemed to give some local concern.
But essentially, what you're looking to do is defer this matter for further information, as I've outlined. Yeah. My only comment would be you have to take into account that, of course, and I'm going to say this in technical terms, that the appellant, the developer could of course appeal for non-determination potentially, but that's a matter for you to take into account.
Well, I mean, I feel the information is available, it just should have been provided.
Okay, we do need just very much, Councillor Dugan, thank you very much. We need a seconder for the deferral. Councillor Wilson.
Thanks, Convener. I'm willing to second the deferral because I think, as Councillor Dugan has said, we've had a lengthy debate, but I think before we even got to the debate, we had a lengthy debate over the questions. And in my opinion, we've more unanswered points than we've answered. I think the issues about flooding, I mean, it was through Mr. Stephen's submission that we discovered that SEPA would not allow this development more than what's in the report. And an explanation of why that was because the rules have changed. Now, we're hitting a moving target with this because, first of all, we give a consent for a 5-metre road without any traffic calming at all. And now we're, because of circumstance, we're having to provide, or suggested to provide, a narrower road, and suddenly traffic calming and road safety becomes a major issue. I'm at a loss to understand why that wasn't addressed previously. Secondly, I think there is a lack of information about SEPA. There still seems to be some mystery, in my mind at least, of why this particular circumstance has changed, why there needs to be extra suds without changing the button at all. If every time we come back to look at something, SEPA change the ground rules, then I think that's creating a rather alarming precedent on what we do, because I'm not convinced that there has been a material change in the situation if you don't change the course of the burn. However, I'd like further information on that. And for these two reasons in particular, also I think a deferral would allow, and I know we've raised issues about what's amenity and what's planning, but there's only three doors to knock on here, Convener. It's not difficult. The developer hasn't knocked on the doors, and as far as I can see, neither have the council planners knocked on the doors. I think some dialogue with the three residents concerned, and we've heard from Councillor Simpson, who's been heavily engaged in this process, and also from Councillor Stewart, who's been involved, also that there is concern that that would allow that opportunity for some sensible consultation to take place, so I'm happy to second the deferral.
Thank you. Just bear with me 1 second. Councillor Dugan, you had something to raise.
Yeah, I just would seek advice, Convener. I'm concerned by the thrust of the amendment insofar as that we need to hear from SEPA directly. The implication being that there's some kind of, you know, fabricated, I should choose my words a bit more carefully, that there's some kind of alternative imperative to having this change to the road. I mean, we've got no control over if or when SEPA reply. Councillor Simpson's hopeful that this won't take very long. It could take forever waiting for SEPA to reply to this particular situation. And I think it might not be too much of a leap of faith for us in this committee to accept that the conversations that have taken place that we've heard about this morning with SEPA have in fact taken place, and they are accurate, and they are exactly what's led us to where we are just now looking at this proposal. So I'm a wee bit concerned about that.
Thank you for that comment. That is for members to take into consideration when we come to that. I have the opportunity, as I've put forward the motion, to sum up. I'm concerned over the way there's been some equal concern on the changes. As the road has been narrowed, that then means that there needs to be some traffic calming put in place. It's because it's not a two-lane road. Because of that, that has raised a concern over how the traffic is going to move. There has been a comment made that when the road was back at its original width of 5.5 metres, then that would have been absolutely fine, and there should have been more work done on that. But it's only because of the sequence of events that we've actually got to look at that. I do think that everything has been looked at and has been looked at properly, and as such, I really do think that we are moving forward with a development that needs to be moved forward. It is requiring two accesses, that has already been stated, and we should be moving ahead with this. So we'll go to the vote. Oh, absolutely, certainly. Yeah. Okay, Councillor Gray, certainly.
Suggest that the traffic calming was a consequence of this amended application, as opposed to it being a requirement of it. Okay.
That's what I was going to say next. Again, slightly flustered today. Councillor Drysdale, due to the fact that you had to leave the meeting in the middle, they won't be able to participate in the vote. Are you aware of that? Okay, thank you. Right, is there any other comments that wish to be made before we move on? No. In that case, we will go to the vote.
Members, just checking, yes, here we go. The motion by Councillor McCall, seconded by Councillor Dugan, is to approve per the paper. The amendment by Councillor Simpson, seconded by Councillor Wilson, is to defer for the two reasons I outlined earlier in relation to further information in terms of the flooding and the traffic calming measures.
Yes, good morning, members. So if when I meet your name out, you can let me know if you'll be voting for the motion as proposed by Councillor McCall and seconded by Councillor Dugan, or the amendment as proposed by Councillor Simpson and seconded by Councillor Wilson, both which has been summarised by Mr. Elliott. Councillor Band.
Motion.
Councillor Barnacle.
Amendment.
Councillor Braun.
Motion.
Councillor Dugan.
Motion.
Councillor Gray.
Motion.
Councillor James.
Amendment.
Councillor McCall.
Motion.
Councillor Simpson.
Amendment.
Councillor Waters.
Motion.
And Councillor Wilson.
Amendment.
Canvas, so there is 6 votes in favour of the motion and 4 in favour of the amendments. Therefore, the motion will carry.
Okay. Committee, thank you very much for that. That was a long and well-debated application, and I appreciate that. That moves us on to the next application, which is in Abernethy. Alterations and extension to building, erection of a cold storage building, including ramp, acoustic fence, installation of air conditioning units, formation of an access road, parking areas, fueling bay, outdoor storage, hard standing areas, landscaping and associated works at Branston Limited, Black Dykes in Abernethy. And I would like to ask Mrs. Conliffe to speak to the report.
Thank you, Convener. Just before I speak to the slides, if I could ask members to look at page 136 and condition 18. On the fourth line of the first sentence, it should refer back to condition 17, not condition 18. So that's on condition 18 itself, and it should refer back to condition 17. To the stills now. On the screen at the moment, you see the proposed layout of the site, which shows both the existing and the proposed new build. The lighter beige colour that you see is the existing buildings that are on the site, and the sort of pinkish colour is the proposed new build. So this is the existing access to the site from the main road, which is the Back Dykes and Newborough Road, and this is at the west end of the site. So this is the existing site, which takes all the traffic in and out of the existing production work. And this is looking at the same access, but looking a little further into the site. The building you see, the single-storey building there at the moment, is the existing offices and the visitor parking. Now, when this development, if it's accepted and agreed, it will then be the main access for all the intake lorries and the visitor access car parking. But there is a proposal that you saw in the first slide which shows a further access at the other end of the site at the eastern end, and that will then have all the staff parking going in and out, and also be the egress for all the HGV lorries. This is on the site. Now, this is where there was previously the potato shed. Now, consent was granted under a previous consent for a replacement of this, so that's why there's work under construction at the moment. So there's a new potato shed would be on the location here. And then we'll just move slightly on to the next one. Now, this is the existing production shed, which has the washing, the sizing, and the grading lines. And there's an extension proposed to this on front of the building, which is roughly in the area where you see the crates stored at the moment and along past that yellow door. This is moving further along that building towards the existing dispatch area. So that's the other side of the last slide. And it's proposed within this that will be a relatively small extension, which will come along this elevation and then it will wrap round to the eastern elevation of that building. And that's still going to be the area for the dispatch. This is a pathway which allows safe pedestrian access through the site. Now, this is what backs onto the existing residential properties that you saw in the first slide, which are on Back Dykes and Newborough Road. So just through the trees towards the right-hand side of the screen, you can just see a fence there. That's the fence that is on the rear of the gardens of the residential properties. Now, the proposal is to have a 3-metre high timber acoustic fence, which will be located on the right-hand side of this existing path. Now, the existing trees that you see to the right will all be retained and supplemented with more landscaping. The trees on the left-hand side, the Lelandii, will all be removed, and the new staff car parking area will be in that area. So the rear of the staff car park will come onto the left-hand side of the path as we look at it. And excuse me. This is the new area for the staff car parking, and the Lelandii that you see there will all be removed from the site. This is at the other end of the site, and there's a proposed cold store which will go down in the northeast corner of the site. So that's down by the trees. The railway runs to the north of that, and then on the left-hand side of the screen towards the east is the area that bounds onto the residential development that was recently at committee. It was approved at this committee just a couple of months ago in May for Haddon developments for the housing. And there was a bund between the two developments which was debated at quite some length on that day. So this cold store will be proposed down in the bottom corner, which is down near the suds area of the housing development and the railway area. And this is the area that will be the new access at the eastern side of the site. So this would be the one where, as I said earlier, the staff car parking would go in and out. Any of the production of the potatoes going in would come out this way, so primarily HGVs will be in and out at this for the dispatch side, but you would still have HGVs going in at the western side. And back to the layout again that shows each of those elements that I've just referred to. Thank you.
Thank you for that, Mrs. Conliffe. I have, Mr. Dimmick is here? Dimmick, sorry, apologies. Thank you very much for your attendance today. You've got 5 minutes to address the committee. You'll get notified when you've got a minute left to go.
Thank you, Convener. Thank you, members. Just to provide a bit of context for the application here today, Branston specialise in potato supply and distribution and are market leaders. The Abernethy Depot, they're a national company, but the Abernethy Depot is the only site in Scotland that the company has. And it's worked well at Abernethy for more than 30 years. Within the last year, the company won a major contract as sole supplier for a large UK food retailer. But to meet the terms of that contract across the whole company, throughput of potato production has to increase. And what the company's found is that Abernethy is a site that needs significant upgrade. In recent years, the applicants have purchased additional land next to their depot in the event that expansion would be called upon, and they've been comforted in those purchases by the fact that those sites have been allocated for employment purposes in two local plans. Now, most of the proposals in this application. There's some new building, but most of the proposals are designed to ease vehicle movement and create a much safer working environment because the present operational site is quite constrained. So aspirations to improve circulation through, improve highway safety, and separate staff movements from HGV and forklift movements. Now, this significant investment is good for Perthshire, it's good for Perthshire growers, and it's good for the companies that service the site, which are mainly based in Perth also. And as your officer report makes clear, presently, because the company's been there so long, and prior to them acquiring the site, it was also a potato merchant site, but presently there are no planning controls in place. So no limits on operational hours, no limits on noise set by planning conditions. The company has effectively self-managed the site. It's been very conscious that it's got housing around it, and it's been very respectful to those neighbours. And in 30 years, Branston's haven't been on the receiving end of an actionable complaint from Environmental Health, which I think says something about site management. Since submission of this application, though, complaints have increased, but there haven't been any changes to the site itself or the operational practices of the company. Now, the applicants recognise that their proposals will change the environment around the site, so they do understand the concerns that some residents might have about change. But members, Branston have engaged with the neighbours around the site. We've had two meetings so far during the course of this application, and they've also written to the neighbours at various stages to advise them of updates to the application. Now, the principal concern that neighbours have expressed through representation has been the height of the 3-metre barrier that Mrs. Conliffe identified is necessary around the site. Now, our studies show on noise that that can effectively contain the operational noise arising from opening the site up, together with other work practices that are set out in the conditions before you, and they're quite onerous. But we've been quite sensitive to that concern about a barrier. So the application's been amended along the way to effectively reduce the height of that fence, but incorporate bunding, planted bunding, to provide a softer edge around the site. Now, a key commercial consideration for the company is to minimise the likelihood of future complaints about noise.
It hasn't one minute, sir.
It hasn't had that problem to date, so it's very conscious that it wants to avoid that. And the studies, through the comprehensive assessment that we've done with noise, has effectively given the company the confidence that with the noise management conditions that are a part of the planning recommendation before you, and with the noise management plan, those issues can be effectively addressed. And the development plan aspiration, the local plan aspiration that any employment use here sits harmoniously with housing can be delivered. Thank you, members.
Thank you very much indeed. Are you happy to take some questions?
Yes.
Councillor Gray.
Thank you. Thank you for the presentation. Now, this is a large industrial site, effectively, rural, with a rural context, which I'm happy to see, with an entrance for HGVs on either side of a village school and housing. Is it the case that HGVs will be intended to enter the eastern one from the eastern side and leave toward the eastern side and vice versa on the western side, if you understand me?
Some of the HGV movements presently come from the east, from Fife and Angus and Aberdeenshire. So they would enter in the eastern site. There's a lot of traffic comes from the M90 and elsewhere in Perthshire. That would continue to use the existing access into the site. I should point out, I don't know if Mrs. Conliffe made this point, but the reopened access on the eastern side formerly served a petrol filling station and engineering workshop. Now they've been gone some years, but it was a busy access. That would have been before the school was constructed on the site, but that formerly was a vehicular access.
Okay. I just really want to establish, will HGVs passing along the street between new accesses be to a minimum because of the arrangement of new
accesses? The transport statement that we've put together with the application has provided some information on typical daily movements and the movements that would change with should this development go ahead. So that increase presently is from 26 intake movements to 32 HGV movements, and dispatch movements from 24 daily to 30. So there will be an increase, Councillor Gray, but the increase is not, in transport terms, significant.
Thank you. Any further questions? Councillor Simpson.
Thank you very much, Convener. You made reference to community engagement at this time, and one of the problems with asking people what they think is they sometimes tell you, and they've obviously done that this time with as regards to noise, but would we be right in assuming that it would be the company's intention to continue with this as this progresses and gets busier and to build on that rather than just carry on hoping that everything's okay?
No, the company's practice very much is to be part of the community, and please, I'm not just saying that, that's very much the impression I've gained in working with them. The intention is to inform them as developments roll out. That is something that the officers have been keen is incorporated in the noise management plan. So at each stage, were new equipment, for example, to be brought onto the site, the obligation is there for Branston to further engage.
Councillor Wilson.
Thanks, Convener. I'm not a fan of Lalandi hedges, but they exist, and here there's a proposal to remove quite a number of them. Is that totally necessary under your proposals, rather than try and retain them? I'm particularly thinking of the one that Mrs. Concliffe was describing, the staff car park, where there seemed to be a good barrier there. Is there any chance they can be retained?
It's something we've looked at closely. They are effective green walls presently. They weren't that height when they went in, of course. Over years, they've grown. The layout that you see before you, the ones on the left-hand side that Mrs. Conliffe pointed out are required to be removed to deliver the parking spaces that we need to meet the standards. So the landscape information we've submitted with this application effectively, essentially identified indigenous species, and some of the residents expressed concern about that in the long term with leaf fall and opening up views into the site at winter. So we've indicated we're happy to explore incorporating within that landscape scheme some evergreens, if you like, and it may be that Lalandi go back as part of that scheme.
Thanks. Or beach is my suggestion. Yeah. Leave that with you. Okay.
Thank you. Councillor Braun.
Good morning, Mr. Dimmock. I'm assuming the site employs a lot of local people, so presumably the expansion will see more local employment for people in the area?
I have to say employment figures won't increase significantly as a consequence of this investment, but it will make the site work more efficiently and more safely. And the company have identified that that is an area where, in terms of operational efficiency, that is a way of remaining competitive. The main driver for this development is to improve quality of stored product, raise standards and maintain consistency. They're contractual obligations that Branston has in terms of supplying this new contract. But at the same time, this can ensure that Branston Abernethy takes its fair share of the load that Branston National has to deliver in terms of meeting the terms of that contract. That in itself will ensure a long-term future for Branston Abernethy.
Employment. Thank you very much. Thank you. Thank you.
Okay. Do we have any further questions? Councillor Barnacle.
Morning. Paragraph 5 of the report says that the existing site is well screened from the public realm and adjacent housing by existing landscaping. And we heard Councillor Wilson's question on removal of some of that hedging. Plus, we've recently consented an extra 39 houses on the mixed-use site. So my concern is that the additional landscaping in your proposals, which are covered by condition two, could you give us an assurance that with these changes, the additional landscaping will eventually, in the long term, give the same amount of screening as currently available?
Thank you, Councillor Barker. What I should have made clear earlier, forgive me, is that along the southern edge of the site presently, there's a mix of existing Lalandi, new mixed species hedging, that's that triangular patch that you can see along the bottom. And then further on there, there's a lot of new young trees have been planted. There are gaps, there's fencing, but there's some mature trees as well. Ranson's intention is not to remove any of those trees that are along the southern boundary. The trees to be removed are those within the site. Now, what you can see, there's a lot of hard surface there on that layout plan. That's necessary for manoeuvrability, safety, parking. The opportunity to break those areas up with planting is something we're happy to look at through the landscaping scheme. But I can't say to you that the same amount of planting within the site will go back that's there at the moment. But the idea is to create this soft edge, this landscape framework around the site itself.
Thank you. Again, committee, do we have any further questions? No, thank you very much indeed for your time this morning.
Thank you.
Thank you. Okay, so I'd like to open up to questions to officers. Do we have any questions for officers on this report? No, a few. Councillor Dugan, thank you.
Thanks, Convener. Officers are presumably then very content with the efficacy of the proposed acoustic screening for this development?
Yes.
Yes, we are. We have spent quite a lot of time with the agent and the applicant on this, and taken on board a lot of the comments made by the residents of Back Dykes and Newborough Road. Allowing for the retention of all of the existing trees that was shown on that slide with the pathway, everything to the right-hand side, that will certainly help. There will then be the acoustic timber fence. And although a lot of the objectors said we would rather keep the Lelandia, it is just not possible because of the width of ground that that takes up. And you'll see from the layout that's on the screen at the moment that there are very large areas, as the agent just pointed out, of hard standing, which is required for just being able to work the site and the manoeuvrability of large vehicles. But what they have done is they've moved the staff car park into the area that is closest to the residential properties, because obviously that has less of an impact in terms of both visual and in terms of noise. But we are satisfied with the levels of landscaping that are proposed and also the noise that has been proposed. There are a lot of mitigation being put in as part of this proposed development.
Any further questions? No? Thank you, committee. Then that allows us to move on. Do we have any comments on the report? No? Then we have a motion. Oh, three hands went up. we'll just work our way along. Okay, Councillor James?
I'm happy to
with the amendment. Yes. Okay. And do you have a seconder? Councillor Wilson?
Thanks, Convener. This is very relevant because we fairly recently give consent for authorised consent rather for residential development in very close quarters adjacent site, and the subject was raised then about what happens when people move into these houses and discover there's a potato processing plant next door to them. Well, buyer beware, I think, is the answer to that. But I think it's good that this proposal has come forward now, so that if anybody is minded to look at the residential site next door, I'm sure there will be, I'm sure it will be successful like many others, that people are fully aware of the proposals here. That I think also of the merit of the application is it gives us control over something that we previously have not had formal control over. There may have been some informal control, and I think that's really important. I was happy with the presentation, and I think the answers that we got, and I'm therefore willing to second the proposal.
Thank you very much. Councillor Gray, do you wish to make a comment?
Yeah, I think I'd agree with that, and I would also like to say that I think the considerable noise mitigation measures hitherto not necessarily in place, but and planning conditions to ensure that they prevail. And I think the employment assurance is a very important issue, because we hear so often of companies, in order to focus on other sites, they tend to close down the ones which are not quite as efficiently built and running and move elsewhere. This is an assurance that employment will remain, as Willie says, Councillor Wilson, sorry, right beside a new source of employee residence. And that has to be a great thing for a rural village. Thank you.
Thank you. Do we have an amendment? No? Then the application is agreed. Thank you. Okay, so this moves us on to the next item of business. Okay, and the one in front of us next is a demolition of building former Lomond Hotel in Main Street, Kinness Wood. And I'd like to ask Mr. Scott to speak to the report.
Thank you, Convener. In advance of doing that, just to advise committee that I'll be giving a presentation covering both items 523 and 524 concurrently. I'll touch on the main issues, so that will relate to the conservation area consent for the proposed demolition of the building, and then you'll see information about the proposed replaced development on that site. Before moving forward then, in that context, for 524, appreciates the second item, but I wanted to give an update at this point that on para 76 on page 172 to 173, reference is made there as to conditions 11 and 12, whereas in fact it should actually be 12 and 13. So just for committee to note that when making a decision on that application. Taking the stills now, the slide that you have in front of you is the site location plan. So as you'll appreciate, the red line sound boundary is the site for where the application is in front of us today. The blue land is land also in control of the applicant. And as noted in the report, there is a planning history associated to both sites. So in terms of the blue site, there is permission in place for the erection of four dwellings in that area. I'll show some stills just to show what that area looks like. But today we're concerned with the red line site boundary, which contains the existing Lomond Inn, and thereafter the proposal is to replace that with a single dwelling house. This is just confirmation of red line site boundary. The red block in the middle is in effect the remaining portion of the Lomond Inn. Permission was previously granted for its retention, but as part of that, there were demolitions and downtakings to some of the accretions and extensions that had historically been added to the building. So the red block that we have left is effectively the original inn, and I'll show some slides in detail just what the condition of that building is at present. This is the proposal, so again the same site. So this is showing post-demolition, as it were, to show what the proposed development on the site would be. As I've advised, the proposal is for the erection of a single dwelling house. So the dwelling house would front on to the main street, that's the A911. Similar to other residential properties within the historic core of Kinness Wood. Access is noted from the main road, largely remaining as it was and is at the moment, and indeed there is planning permission in place for this access to serve the four residential dwellings that are already approved, and you'll see they're noted on this plan as plots 432 on the site, and plot one is the subject of the application for full planning permission for the erection of a two-storey detached dwelling house and a garage, which you can see the garage is located in the northwest corner of the site, and access from the shared road that would serve the other dwellings. This is taken from the eastern approach, approaching to the southwest. This is probably the most prominent position that most people would see of the wider conservation area, but more specifically the existing inn, which you can see is almost the terminal feature looking at the centre of that shot. Taking it slightly forward, a closer view, you can see that the inn, it has been vacant for some period of time. There was a previous permission in place for its retention and conversion, But as noted in the reports, they're seeking authorisation to demolish the building as it remains. You'll note there is quite a poor condition of the building from its front facade, but I'll take you through other elevations as well just to show the condition of the building. So it is recognised that it adds to the character of the conservation area, as you can see from this slide, which is the other elevation. It is in a poor condition, and the effects of weather and periods of time has got to the point, as the report notes, that the viability for the retention and conversion of the building wouldn't be possible. This is the western part of the site, which is the access road, which leads in from the right, which would serve all of the proposed dwellings. And you can see the nature of it being the former car park. It's a relatively open flat area, and it would provide access to the proposed new dwelling. Taken now to the west and south. So this is seeing the principal elevation, which I've touched on before, but also now what is effectively the side elevation. Now, previously, there was a part of a building attached to that, where they had permission to take down that annex and the extensions. At that point, this is what's left that was going to be converted into the proposed dwelling. As the report advises, a structural appraisal and a residential development assessment has been undertaken, and the proposal is to demolish this building. This moving forward, post-demolition, if that were to consider to be acceptable, this is the proposed dwelling that is proposed for erection. So as you can see, similar to the Lomond Inn, it actually has a fairly similar footprint and massing to the Lomond Inn in terms of its height and the land take. The difference being, obviously, this would be a residential property, and it would be the northeast elevation would actually front on to the public road rather than having a gable end arrangement as currently exists for the Lomond Inn. And this takes you back to the site location plan.
Sorry, thank you, Mr. Scott. Okay. Just give me a second, right, please. Yes, we have Mr. Mitchell available here to answer any questions that you may have. Thank you very much for your attendance today, Mr. Mitchell. You're not making a deputation, so there's no time frame, but certainly open up to any questions from the committee. Do we have any questions for Mr. Mitchell? Yes. Councillor Barnacle, apologies.
Morning,
Councillor Barnacle.
I've got two questions. In October 2016, the committee approved part demolition of the hotel and also the erection of four dwelling houses. That was against the wishes of all four local members at the time and quite a considerable proportion of the community. So the first thing I would say is, why has it taken you since then to now before you've come forward with this current proposal? And secondly, it's alleged in the representations that you've actually allowed the building to fall into disrepair and made no attempt to retain it, and in fact removed slates, which has contributed to the deterioration of the building. What do you say to those allegations?
What happened when we got the original planning permission back in 2016, that was for a reduction in size of the Lomond Country Inn. I designed the structure as a residential unit that we hoped it would be suitable for conversion into residential property. Unfortunately, after we obtained our permission, you granted it subject to signing Section 75. That process went through. When we got the permission, we had to look at how, from a demolition warrant point of view, we had to process that to get permission from the council to take down part of the existing structure. Then when we were looking closely at the building, the wall, the gable to the main road, structurally that was unsafe. And when the structural engineer assessed that wall, there was stonework, brickwork, timber, all within there without a foundation. And because it was built right onto the highway, and the floor was lower than the highway, that created structural implications. So that's when we had to look at how we could try and overcome that problem. So I I designed a new build trying to replicate what we had got permission for to retain. And we did put an application in, but then we were asked that that wasn't, it was a pastiche of what was there. And if we were going to go forward with a financial and structural argument that you couldn't safeguard that section of the building, what you'd have to then, why couldn't you consider trying to get a design that was more relating to the existing conservation area? So that's how there was a passage of time, and that's how we eventually put this application in. during the process, Mr. Sinclair, who owned the site, when he was looking to try and take forward the conversion of the Lomond Inn, we had to go through a due process with the ecologist, and the slates had to be removed under his supervision. So there was a time frame when you had to physically be able to do that. Slates were removed and safeguarded for reuse. But it was, as I say, through the process of the demolition that we basically uncovered the constructional detail of the building. The age of the building is 100 odd years old, and a lot of it doesn't have foundation. So with the heavy HGVs that go through the main street, you get vibration on there through the gable end of the building. And actually, the structural engineer asked building control to come out and have a look because there was concerns on safety. So that's through the process. Then we looked at, if we were going to do a new build, could we improve it by creating a footpath along the edge of Main Street that would improve the public safety? So the building was set back from the Main Street and trying to improve and enhance the edge of the settlement at that point. Okay.
Thank you. Any further or supplementary questions?
You're probably aware that there's quite a lot of interest in the site from interim community trust that's been set up, and there have been a few meetings about that, which I think you were aware of. And they still wish to engage regarding certain aspects of the site development. I just wondered why you hadn't really chosen to do that.
I understand Mr. Sinclair attended two of the community council meetings. So he went along and he was answering questions. Mr. Sinclair, who owns the site, he resides in Kinesswood now, in temporary accommodation, and he envisages that plot two, that's going to be for himself, the one that's already consented. His children go to Portmore Primary School, and he does have dialogue with a lot of residents through the primary school. So a lot of the residents there have advised him that they would have liked to have seen the site tidied up, the building removed, and the new build project commencing. It is his intention to do as fast as possible if permission is granted by yourselves today.
Do we have any other further questions? Councillor Brown.
Just a quick one, Mr. Mitchell. Good morning.
Morning.
Just to clarify, are you saying the building is unsafe as it is at the moment? The vibration of traffic coming past, or at least part of it closest to the road?
Part of it is the gable end of the existing building borders right on the edge of the carriageway.
Yeah.
And there's cracking in there. Yeah. And within the structural report, there are photographs of the internals of that gable. Mm-hmm. And that's where the engineers picked up that there's a mixture of materials. But then just the pure vibration has created that issue on the structure. And the concern, from when I first viewed the property, there's concerns with parts of the age of the building, parts of the wall structure do not have a foundation. So you've got to underpin that foundation. Mm. Then you've got the floor construction, and that doesn't have proper damp-proof coursing in it. So these are all added to the constructional costs. Mm. It was, if we go back to 2016, when I looked at trying to retain the building, come up with a design solution that worked. in design terms, but it was only through the process that structural engineers and the financial surveyors assessing it said that structurally, financially, it's not viable. So that's when I was asked to review that and come up with a design solution that was a new build. And then, as I initially tried to make a pastiche of what was there, so we could have had the elevation from the approach from the east. But through discussions and consultations, said, let's try and get something more relating to the existing conservation area. So that's what we've done.
Thank you.
Again, or do we have any further questions? No? Mr. Mitchell, thank you very much indeed for your time this morning.
Thank you.
Or this afternoon, as it is now. Thank you. So I open up to councillors' questions to officers. Do we have any questions? Councillor Barnacle.
Are we just dealing with the demolition at the moment? Or are we dealing with both? The demolition. Yeah. I think there is there's a condition to reuse the existing roof slates should we demolish the building. Could that be done for the old stonework in the building as well on the site? I have a view on demolition, but where we are now, could that condition be added?
Mr. Scott, is that possible? Or
yeah, it potentially could be considered that upon the downtaking that stone is set aside for evaluation for potential future use. I think the proposed dwelling would actually be a rendered building, so it probably wouldn't be likely suitable, but any additional walls or anything that is proposed, it might be possible to use that. But it wouldn't be substantially used in a replacement building because the building is of a different outward appearance and construction type. So it might not be, have that much advantage.
I understand that, yeah.
Any further questions for officers? Councillor Wilson.
Thanks, Convener. I'm on page 152. And I just want to have a verbal reassurance from officers. That's the bits 48, 49, 50, barras 51, 52, where there's a clear indication in my mind that we've sought professional, external professional advice, right? And if that's not the right terminology, then keep me right, please. But external professional advice regarding A, the condition of the building, and B, the viability costs of conversion. And we're just confirming that in plain language, the building's done. It's an old Scots expression. I think everybody in the room, I hope, will understand what it means. Sadly, and secondly, that the conversion cost is not financially viable. I just want a confirmation that my understanding of that is what these paragraphs mean.
To summarise, yes, you are correct. The structural assessment has been considered by our own internal structural engineers within our property team. They're satisfied that that assessment undertaken by a RICS qualified surveyor is entirely appropriate. The condition of the building is evidently a very poor condition. So yes, the building, the condition has been accepted. In terms of the cost for the residential development, that assessment again has been independently assessed by officers within the council, and they accept that the methodologies and approach that they've undertaken are actually rather conservative, and the deficit of the conversion of that 415,000 more than clearly demonstrate that it's not a viable proposition to convert that building.
Okay, any further questions? No? Thank you very much. I open it up to comments, or do we have Councillor Gray?
Yep, I think sadly, for the reasons given by Mr. Scott just now, it's not viable anyway, either structurally or economically. Therefore, we must agree with the paper and see a demolition of this building, sadly.
Okay, do we have a second? Councillor Wilson?
Convener, I maybe should have declared an interest at the beginning in this because I have sat and eaten and had a light refreshment in this place in the past. There's been a huge amount of effort by local members, one of them is here, and certainly Councillor Barnacle and Councillor Robertson. Councillor Waters will speak for himself in the last 2 years, but to try and make something else happen with this, and there's been a lot of community interest. There is a history, and it's always a great regret to me, and I think to most people in the room, that if you allow something to moulder, and this has been allowed to moulder, there's no doubt about that, right? Then you end up with what Mr. Scott has just summarised. It is done, sadly. It's not an easy decision, but if we put it off, then I think we're going to be back here again in X weeks, months' time, with a similar dilemma. It's not a happy situation. It was a lovely hotel in a lovely location overlooking the loch. But time moves on. And I think, given what we've heard, we should approve this report. I say with regret, there's no emotion in planning, of course, you've not allowed that. But it is a sad day to see this building going, but I don't think we're left with any viable alternative.
Is that you seconding the motion?
Yeah.
Thank you.
With a degree of emotion and empathy for Councillor Barnacle's situation.
Absolutely. Totally noted. Okay, so we have a motion. Do we have an amendment to the paper?
Sorry, convener. Can I just ask? I think it is, safety wise has to come first as well. And if we've got engineers' reports saying that the building is not safe, especially given the proximity of the gable end to the main carriageway, it leaves very little option on what we can do here. Coming back to some of Councillor Barnacle's questions on reusing the stone, and I know from the drawings that they're looking at doing a 1 point. If we're minded to pass the next application that comes forward for the new house, but whatever happens in there, I think are we covered within our current conditions, or to make sure that we put a condition into where possible the old stone from the building will be reused in whatever happens within that space or within the development.
Yeah, I think that sounds like a reasonable request. I'll just ask if that is something that can be done.
Yeah, moving ahead to the full planning permission recommendation, condition 6 there is to form that wall with natural stone, some of which does already exist, but if you felt appropriate, as I've touched on earlier, you could seek to set aside some other stone to supplement that or provide for elsewhere in development. I think as part of the conservation area consent, that would be appropriate.
Would that happen in this application, or would that have to happen in the subsequent the application for the...
Both, in effect. You'd seek to control it for the demolition to make sure it was taken down in such a manner that you could set aside so it's capable of being reused, and then potentially supplement condition 6 that any stone that has been verified as being reusable is then used in the wall or anywhere else.
Yeah. I'm not sure whether as part of the motion this committee would just include that within the motion, or whether I would have to put an amendment forward.
It's partly in 6 already, yeah. But when we come to consider 6, if you do wish to add it in for the conservation area consent, it can be an extra condition that we could have for the conservation area consent. And for condition 6, it would be putting into motion the use of that stone for the rebuild, where appropriate.
Councillor Greer, are you happy for that to be added?
Yeah, if there is stone usable in that area, I would be very happy if it was used again within that area in the conservation village. After all, mainly no.
Mr. Scott, you wish to say something?
Yeah, potential solution rather than additional condition. My colleagues just highlighted condition 3 seeks a verification of the existing slates for reuse in the new building. You could extend that to be slates and stone. So therefore, you're setting aside the appropriate, and it's getting tested to see if it's appropriate to be used. And then thereafter, there are conditions on the full planning permission for the reuse already of the slate, but it could be extended to be stone in the walls or any other area.
Okay, Councillor Gray, your agreement. Councillor Wilson, are you happy with that?
Yes.
in your second position. Thank you. Okay. Councillor Barnacle.
I agree that where we are now, the demolition should be approved. But I would like to make a comment because it's been put to me by the community that should we approve these demolition oblique new build applications for the Lomond Inn, it does give a green light to any developer to acquire any old property of any heritage value, demolish it in due time, and rebuild entirely with modern houses, which effectively ignores the planning policies we have in place to counter that. So I would like that to be thought about in other situations that may arise, and there have been a number of them. So because of where we are with the building, I see no alternative but to demolish it. But I regret that we've got to that stage with this particular building. And I too have fond memories of using it when it was a well-run establishment, well frequented by the community. Thank you.
Your comments and the comments of the community through yourself are duly noted. Thank you for bringing them out. Okay, do we haven't had an amendment. I just don't think there is one, but I just want to make sure that that is done. Do we have an amendment for that? No? In that case, the application is approved, and we will move on to the second part. Thank you. Including the amended conditions. Thank you. Okay, so the second part of the still that's up there. Okay. I'm happy to I'll call a recess for a couple of minutes for a comfort break if anyone wants to do so. No? Then in that case, we'll start. Okay. So we're on to 524, an erection of a dwelling house and garage, land 40 metres northwest of Bonnelly Cottage, Main Street in Kenniswood. And I would like to ask Mr. Scott to speak to the report.
Yeah, just to summarise, in accepting the demolition for the previous build of conservation area consent, the recommendation is to approve this subject to conditions. We did touch on the potential for an additional condition for the reuse of stone. So part of this recommendation, condition 8, is the verification of the existing slates. So in a similar manner, if committee were so minded to tie in with this decision they've just made, that could be extended to be including of stone. Other than that, I have no further comment.
Mr. Mitchell, I asked you to come back. Thank you again. Obviously the same situation as before. Committee, do you have any questions for Mr. Mitchell? Councillor Band, thank you.
Thank you, Camille. Can I ask Mr. Mitchell, are the original slates still accessible?
They are still accessible. What we've got to do is look at them closely and see the quantity of them, and then look at the amount that's available on what elevation. There wouldn't be sufficient to cover the full structure, so it's a matter of looking at the design and whether it's on the garage or on the rear projection, but it's to get a plane where you can apply the slate that will be uniform on that elevation. There might be new slate, similar style, on the Main Street elevation, or if they're sufficient to do the Main Street elevation, that's where the old slate would be applied. But that assessment is to be carried out.
Certainly.
So we can confidently say that the design that you produce will have a slated roof, and where possible, the existing slates will be on one elevation, and with new slate or second-hand slate from elsewhere,
the design for the conservation area, the proposal has to be in natural slate. There are some properties, the property opposite, that is in concrete roof tiles and UPVC windows and detail that shouldn't really have been in the conservation area, but the proposal here is to use materials
that reflect the conservation area. The selection of the colours of the render, I assessed the contextual analysis of the properties within, looked at the window designs, looked at the materials. There's a lot of stone buildings, but there's a lot of rendered buildings. There's some in the street that have the cream with the grey window, the banded window surrounds. That's what's proposed on here. So I say the natural slate is on the roof. Previously on the design to save, try and retain part of the Lomond Inn, we were retaining the idea to introduce again cast iron rainwater goods. That's a condition which will happen. On the windows, I'd proposed a timber composite window structure, so it's timber internally with an alu-clad externally. Part of the reason there is you get the white finish, but it's to have a reduced maintenance, and that was accepted on the proposals before, so again it's conditioned that we would hope that we'd do the same, and that's what's going to happen on the proposed structure if it's approved. So all the materials are there. The issue on the slate, I can't confirm to you today what quantity has been safeguarded. All the material that come off the roof has been palleted and it's there, but it has to be assessed by a roofer. It has to be dressed, taken down, and then the square meterage coverage of it will be looked at. It wouldn't look right if the main plane running parallel with the main street, if you could only do 3/4 of that roof, you wouldn't put it on that elevation. You try and find another part. So it's just to try and get a uniform, nice finish to a plane on the roof structure. And it might be that the material element is only sufficient to do the garage structure. But where we can reuse it, in conjunction with discussion with the planning officers, part of compliant with these proposed conditions, at due process, we will go through that, try and assess it, and try and reach agreement what would be used.
Thank you. Any further questions for Mr. Mitchell? Councillor Barnacle.
Oh, sorry.
I can also confirm that I've one of the conditions that was proposed, that I've got to draw an elevation of the proposed stone wall that will enclose the back garden. And that's, I need to get stone material to do that, and would propose that boundary walls, you wouldn't want to do them in render because there's a chance of the dampness coming onto them and it's falling off, so it's better that there's a natural stone finish. So the wall that's going to be from the northwestern end, taking that boundary which is enclosing the back garden, that 1.2 high structure wall will be natural stone, and the stonework that we can take down, if we can put that aside for assessment, that would be incorporated in that wall, and any other small wall enclosures within to enclose the back garden. So that'll be part and parcel of the due process if it's determined favourably that we would agree with the planning officer.
Okay, thank you for that additional information. I think that's everything. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Okay, I open up questions to officers. Councillor Barnacle, you had a question?
Yeah, I've got two questions. We already have a planning approval on the site for some houses to be built, which has not taken place yet. But do you feel, because obviously there's been representation that the feeling is from the community that they would have preferred to have seen a better design and a lower scale of the building, but do you feel from your assessment that this proposal will fit in with what's already been consented in terms of scale and design? Because that's an important context here. That's the first question. And the other question relates to the issue around the interest by the community in the land. As I understand it, you cannot take forward community trust situation just simply to thwart a planning application. I've noticed that this has been unsuccessful elsewhere. So I'm assuming that concept is rather late in the day, and not appropriate in dealing with this application.
Taking your first point, we have fully assessed, as we're obliged to do so, before agreeing that the demolition of the building in the conservation area is appropriate, you've got to make sure that the scheme in and itself is also appropriate as a replacement. Subject to the design amendments that have been secured through this permission, I think the agent referred that a previous application was withdrawn because we didn't consider it to be an appropriate design solution. So it has been redesigned and reorientated. The scale and height of the building is actually similar than the previous inn, and it's quite characterful of the appearance of the wider conservation area. So the location of the building, and subject to securing the details for the slate, the finish of the building, yes, I actually think it would be a positive contribution to the conservation area, accepting the fact that the old building will come down. In terms of your second point, you're correct, it can't be used in such a manner, and it would be, I think you put it, it's too late. It's not a consideration at this point in time because we don't have a community proposal. We have to assess the planning application on its merits based on the situation as it is at the moment. So on that basis, that's why the application is recommended for approval.
Any further questions for officers? No? Thank you very much indeed. Okay, we will move on to comments. Any comments? Councillor Wilson?
I would like to move the report.
Okay, are you happy with the amended condition regarding the...
Yes.
Do we have a second for the motion? Well, I'm happy to second the motion again with the amended condition. Do we have an amendment? No? Then the application is approved. Thank you very much. Okay. Right, the next item of business today is an erection of a dwelling house and garage, land 40 metres northwest. No, I've done that. That's repeated. Sorry, I do apologise. The application in front of us is Mackay's Hotel. As approval of the application considered to comply with relevant... Mackay's Hotel, 138 144 Athol Road, Pitlochry, and I'll ask Ms. Conliffe to speak to the report.
Thank you, Convener. This first slide shows the existing layout of Mackay's Hotel, which fronts onto Athol Road. The proposed extension is that yellow area that you see on the screen at the moment. There is an extant consent for an extension to the hotel, which was previously granted, and the proposal now is to slightly reduce the scale of that proposal. This is just showing the frontage of Mackay's Hotel and the main entrance, which comes from Athol Road. You won't be able to see from Athol Road the extension proposed at the back until you're further west along the site. And this is looking up Burnham Place. That's still all the Athol Mackay's Hotel that you see on the left-hand side, the white building. It's white painted, the stonework. And then if you follow up there, you can see the wall and then a pillar at the end. And that's the entrance, the rear entrance into the site, which shows the car park. And that's approximately the junction with Greenside Road. And then we're looking from that point at the junction with Greenside Road back down. On the left-hand side, you can see back down to Athol Road. And then that's the car park into the site. That's the rear of the Mackay's Hotel that you can see at the moment with the two gables. And the extension will come from that to approximately where you see the rear of that car parked in the car park. And this is just showing that same position. So where you see the roof, which is actually the roof of the function room of the hotel, above that will be the proposed bedroom extension, which, as it says in the report, is 12 bedroom extension. And this is showing the car park. There has been points raised by representations on car parking. Our transport planning team are satisfied with the level of car parking that it meets standards. But as you'll see, the current car park is unsurfaced and is not delineated in any form. And therefore there's a bit more ad hoc parking. So the suggestion, if this was approved, one of our recommended conditions is to have the car park surfaced and delineated to allow a better and more efficient use of that car park area. And that's us back to the layout plan that we showed on the first slide. Thank you.
Thank you, Mrs. Conliffe. Okay. Do we have any questions for officers on this particular application? No? Okay, thank you. Do we have any comments? No? Well, do we have a motion? Councillor Wilson.
I'll move the report.
And I'm happy to second the report. Do we have any amendments? No. In that case, the application is approved. Thank you. And that brings us on to the last item of business today, which is a PAN, a residential development of land, 70 metres east, and I'm going to say this wrong because I'm not very good at it, Tigranach St Ninian's Road in Aylith. Okay, I'm just asking for comments on this so that it can go forward to the planning department. As I've stated many times when it comes to this, I do think this is where the front end part of the planning is put forward. The whole proposal works this way. So if we have anything that we wish to mention to the planners before the application comes forward, I think I would appreciate it. So, Councillor Drysdale.
Thank you, Convener. Yeah, just one issue, looking at the final page of our papers and the map, noting the proximity of a cemetery to this site. I'm not clear from the drawing whether the cemetery is just in that little bit down at the corner or whether it's actually it covers the area nearer to the proposed development site. But in any event, can we ensure that any plans coming forward are respectful of the cemetery area and conscious of difficulties that may have arisen in other crematoria in Perth and Kinross. I think we need to pay particular attention to that aspect.
Thank you, Councillor Simpson.
Just one comment again. If we look at the map on page 207, it would be helpful, I think, if a transport colleague could do some assessment as to which direction they think the traffic will enter and leave by, whether they'll go towards New Aylith and down towards Bergowrie, or whether they're going to Aylith and out again, both for the residents, I think, and more importantly for the construction traffic, because the wee road up from New Aylith is not necessarily the widest carriageway in Perthshire, you know.
Thank you. Any other comments? No? Committee, thank you very much for your attendance today. Thank you. Thank you.